I have the honor and pleasure to introduce Nobu Okada-san, who is the CEO and founder of Astroscale. Astroscale was founded in 2013 to respond to the growing need to address space debris as a business opportunity and business challenge. Had the pleasure to work with Nobu and his team in a variety of contexts over the last several years, and I always enjoy those interactions and their contributions very much. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Nobu. Nobu is here to tell us about Astroscale's approach to the space sustainability ecosystem. Nobu-san, over to you.
Hi, thank you. I'm Nobu Okada, founder and CEO of Astroscale. So thank you for inviting me, Secure World Foundation, to this critical dialogue on space accessibility. Over the last 2 days, there have been variable discussions on space accessibility from a civil, commercial, and military angle, and anything from astronomy, behaviors, space forces, remediation, cislunar, and incentives. I am equally impressed, but not surprised that the topic of sustainability touches so many segments of the space ecosystem. Thank you for the slide. So sustainability, it is an overused word from agriculture to transport to fashion to even tuna. But when we apply to space, what does it really mean? For me, it's net positive. Click next, please. So it's a net positive. It's not about stopping the development in space. It's not about adding cost to operators. It's not just about considering the future generations and doing the right things. It's a net positive in market size. It's a net positive in accessibility, net positive in risk management. And it touches so many areas. So let me be clear on what net positive exactly means. Next. Whether here on Earth, in LEO, in GEO, cislunar orbit, or on the moon itself, space accessibility ecosystem is a future where we have on-orbit servicing, such as next, active debris removal, next, life extension, next, refueling, next, orbit transfers, next, space situational awareness and inspection, next. And manufacturing, and next. End of life. So it's a future on-orbit servicing can holistically represent a sustainability ecosystem for Earth's orbits and beyond. Next, please. We can change industry from waste culture to space accessibility ecosystem by expanding the value chain with the advancement of RPO technologies and putting in the right set of regulations and incentives. So far, we have been in a throwaway culture by doing just R&D, AAV, launch, and operate. But by adding maintenance and disposal, the space industry can be on the same level as the automobile industry, shipping industry, and aviation industry. The automobile industry doubled by creating the automotive aftermarket. It could reduce the lifetime cost for the owners and reduce the traffic accident risks. And in the end, the automobile industry could expand their users and utilities. So why not do the same in space? To make it reality, we need reliable RPO technologies for both controlled and uncontrolled objects in space and the right set of regulations. The waste culture market size is $108 billion per year. It's too early to say how big the space accessibility ecosystem market could become, but there is clear value in lowering lifetime cost for operators and reducing the risks. Next. So what Astroscale does, Astroscale has over 140 employees across 5 countries. We were, as Ian said, we were founded 7.5 years ago with a vision to secure the safe and sustainable development of space for the benefit of the future generations. And we are also the only company solely dedicated to on-orbit servicing across all orbits. We are supporting the function of a vibrant, sustainable future in space. Technically, we are developing missions of end-of-life services, active debris removal, and in-situ space situational awareness and life extensions. We are soon going to launch ELSA-D and later on Address-J and the LEX. And we will start these services within a couple of years. Next. So let me show the CONOPS video of ELSA-D, the world first debris removal demonstration. Sorry for busy sounds. So we will bring the servicer and the client together, and we will separate the client first. And we will capture, we will have a capture testing without tumbling first. The servicer uses a magnetic docking mechanism while the client has a ferromagnetic plate. Second demonstration will separate with the tumbling. So this is more realistic capture, more dynamic. Our servicer will monitor the client satellite and then identify the rotation motion. And the servicer will synchronize the rotation rate. It's a quite unique motion. And alignment, and we capture them. The third demonstration, we will separate the target, separate the client, and we will lose it. We start from the searching mode. We use a very unique trajectory to safely approach the client. And after capturing, we will demonstrate the deorbit. And we will bring them down to the atmosphere in the burn and the complete re-entry. Sorry, it was a bit noisy music, and then the video was not smooth enough. So we have a flight model there, and we are just waiting for shipment, and we are going to launch from a Soyuz rocket in Kazakhstan soon. And then, we are not just focused on developing. So this RPO technologies will cut across all the services like used for other services too, like active debris removal and life extension, and then SSA. And then, we are not just focused on developing the technology. In a business sense, we have attracted smart investors, and we got plenty of funding to get off the get off the ground. We've raised more than $140 million so far, and we are expecting more. And also, we are forging a new path in business concepts for in-orbit services as well. And we have ELSA-D is developed by ourselves, but now we have multiple contracts, and then we have some funding in the customers. And in the policy sense, this is where our global presence pays off. We have the opportunity to be a voice in international, domestic, industry, NGO, local, and public dialogue. We believe in the power of industry best practices, and we are proud members of CONFIRST, ESOA, CSSMA, and Space Safety Coalition and some other groups in the world. This is the last slide. So this is the steps toward net positive in the space sustainability ecosystem. And we have more, but we try to make this kind of a concise. The first, let's improve SSA. Let's share data to the extent we can, like position data and maneuver plans, and also ensure your spacecraft can be tracked and being tracked and uniquely identified. And then without monitoring, without properly measuring, we cannot have a proper traffic control. And avoid collision. Let's be maneuverable and use propulsion or other techniques to avoid collisions with the trackable objects. Let's deorbit at the end of life. As we see the hot topic about the post-mission disposal rate in ODMSP or FCC, we are expected to higher the PMD rate. And then every satellite should have their own deorbit mechanism, but prepare for the unexpected and design spacecraft to be captured in the end, if some anomaly occurs. And then if you cannot deorbit by yourself, please use a backup deorbit plan, which we provide. And remove critical debris. I'm not sure how many people read the new, kind of recent article, but an international group identified the top 50 most critical objects in space to be removed. And this is a great step. And I know Japan and Europe have initiatives for these large object removal. And also yesterday, NASA administrator mentioned that they should incentivize remediation. So, thanks to this conference, I really hope removing critical objects will become a big trend in the world soon. And finally, let's advocate for safe and sustainable space environment, and to policymakers, regulators, legislators, and your customers, colleagues, we know problem. We know problem. And the space sustainability ecosystem is a net positive. So let's switch to the net positive and expand the market and sustainable. And to do that, we need to continue advocating. That's a brief explanation of Astroscale, and then I'm happy to answer any questions. Thank you, Nobu.
I mean, we do have a number of very interesting questions. I think you've done a good job of getting the audience interested and engaged and advocating that message that you delivered there. So I appreciate that. And the first question actually is very much picking up on the last point you were making about how we advocate for space sustainability and for addressing these objects that we know we need to remove to improve the sustainability domain. And for those of you that are monitoring, we just shared the link to the top 50 objects article that Nobu just mentioned in the chat. So you can read that at your leisure. So the question, Nobu, is picking up on what you were just talking about. One of the big challenges that we have is convincing governments to step up and commit resources to space sustainability. So you mentioned pilot programs and the European Space Agency has done and the Japanese government has done. Do you have any recommendations or further recommendations on how we can really effectively as a community advocate to those governments to step up and continue to build out on those sorts of programs?
My answer is very simple. There's no silver bullet for this. There's no magic for this. So what I have done is just fly, get there, meet, and talk, and tell. And so people, and so now kind of regulators understand space debris issue, but they do not understand how urgent it is. So we should continue educating them. I think that's the only way and the shortest cut to made a regulation toward more favorable to the sustainability.
Thank you. And so I'm going to ask a follow-on to that question. you obviously, and you mentioned in your talk, you've developed a set of investors that are interested in the work that Astroscale is doing and see the value in this opportunity from a business standpoint. Is there any similarity in the value concept that you present in investor discussions to the advocacy message that you would take to governments?
The investors invest in us because they believe in there'll be the market later. But so the first we have to convince them there is a problem. So if issue is not clear, it's very hard for them to invest. But the issue is clear. The question is how long it takes. You know, it takes 30 years or 5 years, 3 years. And then so what I did, I showed the plan. This is a plan. And then what's the world trend? And then, but for example, for those who I met 2 years ago, they didn't believe, but now they see the proliferation of the discussion of the space accessibility in the world. And then, oh, I see. So now people are really taking care of the space accessibility. So now they decide to invest in us. So it takes time to convince them, but you know, the again, it in the end, it's the belief, you know, how long it takes, but there's a difference among the investors' acceptance.
Yeah. Thank you for that. So one of my beliefs is that as we advocate as a community for space sustainability and to address the challenges that Astroscale and others are trying to, when convincing government, it helps to have multiple stakeholder groups that are interested in the topic so that the governments are not just hearing about it from operators, they're not just hearing about it from businesses like Astroscale, they're not just hearing from Secure World Foundation, but if investors become interested, if end users become interested, it helps make that case in the long term. And it is a pathway that's going to take a little bit of time. So we now have a set of questions that I'm going to try and address that ask about the government role in early phase, early stages of the business, and how you transition from government role to private. More private driven markets. So question from Peter B. DeSelding. Nobu, would you agree that for active debris removal to become a business, it will require a large amount of government funding to jumpstart it, or can the private sector take the lead?
So my belief is that polluter pays money. Polluter should pay for the money. You know, the existing debris, most of them were littered by the government, so they should pay. And then, so going forward, most of the debris might come from constellations, so they have to pay. And then the question is how much they need, right? I mean, once they understand the importance of debris removal, their next question, how much they have to pay. And if it takes, for example, 500 million to remove one debris, it's gonna be the big number in the end. But if it takes 50 million or 30 million to remove one debris, and then if we have removed only 50 or even only 200, you know, they can calculate, you know, and then, you know, it's not unlimited. There's a certain number of the money. And then if we split among the key like-minded countries, how much they have to pay for each, then they digest, and then they feel like, okay, it's feasible. So I think now the stage is still early, but the Europe and Japan already decided to fund developing the technologies for large object debris removal, and I hope US will come soon. So I think once technology is proven, like what we saw in a Fulon, Fulon destroyed the ozone layer, and then until alternative fuel comes to the world, the world couldn't do anything. But once alternative fuel comes, they quickly change their mind and created agreement across the world. So I think that once we prove the technology, the world will, you know, move forward, I think.
All right, thank you. And so polluter must pay, and focusing on government, since it's in the initial case, because it's the historic objects, and I think most of the objects on that top 50 list are government legacy objects. But you also mentioned the large constellations that are coming. And so we have a question from the audience. Have you had conversations with those large constellation operators about their interest in designing their satellites to be potentially removable at end of life.
Yeah, so we are talking with various large constellations, and so their kind of understanding of a responsible manner is different. But for example, OneWeb, they announced to mount the kind of docking plate to be captured later. And then there is a magnetospheric plate there so that this is compatible with our ELSA satellite. So they are prepared for the failure. So it's just like one case, but we are also talking with the other constellations too. Yeah. So I think the understanding is getting better and better.
Thank you for that. So we have about 10 minutes left and more questions than we're probably going to be able to get to. So thank you to the audience for submitting lots of good questions. I'm going to try and move through some in rapid fire here. So Nobu, I want to shift to the legal and policy side of things. You mentioned that as an area of emphasis for Astroscale and your involvement in industry best practice groups and working with governments on the regulatory questions. So the question we have is a legal obligation to remove debris, which is currently not something that we have in place, essential for your business? Do you need international action to enable legal removal of debris to make your plan close?
Legal action. So, for example, look at the Japanese government. They are discussing, you know, there are certain number of the large object in space, and then the question whether Japanese government needs kind of law to remove them. It's not. As long as they have an action plan, that's fine. And then if we expand the kind of coalition to the like-minded country, I don't think that kind of a law is needed or treaty is needed. Just as long as they agree on actions, that's good enough. I hope I'm answering your question.
I think it begins to answer it. Yeah, I mean, it's the international conversation on this topic will continue, right? And it's as national governments make action, that will contribute to the larger international conversations. All right, a couple of sorry to jump, but now a couple of technical questions about the ELSA-D mission and video that you presented. So we have a couple of questions about the third demo step, the spiral trajectory as you're hunting. What is the purpose of that? And are there any concerns about power availability from the solar panels during those maneuvers or connections to the TT and C links?
I guess in multiple angles, but that trajectory is to avoid any unexpected collision. So even if our service go anomaly, defunct during the searching mode, we will not kind of passively avoid collision. So
it's a safety mitigation step as part of the mission design. Okay.
Right. And then as you said, our satellite have a very unique motion. It's really hard to manage the power budget. It's true, and also communication budget too. So, but we found a way how to solve this.
Okay. So you are aware of these issues in the mission designing, and you're looking at that and have a plan to mitigate it. So appreciate that. Yeah. 5 minutes or so left. So let's look at the, so we've been talking about the active debris removal part of the business, but recently Astroscale made an acquisition of Effective Space in the UK and moved into the satellite life extension market. So how does that relate to the ADR work that you're doing? And is there the service plan, the business plan for the life extension, is it similar to what Space Logistics is doing with the mission extension vehicle?
Yes. First of all, the Space Logistics demo was great. I think it opened the door for orbit servicing. So I really appreciate that. And then the so it was the acquiring effective solutions technology IP and was not the new stuff for us. We discussed for a long time, and then actually there it's again it's an RPO technology, runnable proximal operation technology, which we can have a synergy together. And then so over the next 15 years, 475 satellites will retire, and actually some of them, many of them needs a life extension. So there will be the market, and there's clear economic reasons for that.
Okay, thank you. Short one, is Astroscale looking into recycling orbital debris in the future?
So good question, because when we talk about environmental technologies, it's always start with reduce, reuse, recycle, right? 3 R's. And I believe we can, now we are doing the reduce the debris and then reduce the launch by life extension. And then we want to move to reuse by having deferring capability in space and in the midterm. But the question of recycling, we are not yet started the feasibility study yet, but we definitely want to double check whether recycling can be done in space.
All right, thank you for that. All right, so we are coming to the end here. I'm just looking through the questions one more time. So Nobu, I think the last question that I wanted to ask you is one that's looking towards the future. So you've outlined a business case, you've outlined the vision, and you've shown us the demonstration mission that is hopefully launching very soon, right? And you mentioned you're looking at life extension and the importance that space logistics had that first demonstration mission, commercial demonstration mission, is successful. What is the biggest milestone that you're looking for in terms of showing that active debris removal is a viable business case, a viable commercial opportunity going forward?
Thank you. I have a clear milestone. So by 2030, I want to make kind of orbit servicing as just a routine work. Not, it's kind of a very normal generic service in space. So it happens every day. Like if you throw the garbage on the road, the garbage truck will pick up, right? The same thing. It's a kind of triple A on the highway. If there's a defunct car, the triple A will tow it. So same in space. And to do that, we have only 10 years. It's very, very short. So if we kind of trace, come up with action list to achieve there, there are so many things. Now we are planning to develop a large entity, large facility to be able to have manufacture multiple satellites. And then, so there are lots of things. And so we're quite busy right now.
Well, 2030 as a milestone for routine on-orbit servicing, I think we would all love to have routine on-orbit servicing available and a robust ecosystem of actors providing and utilizing those services. So I will hold you to that deadline, Nobu-san, and we will work through that as a community to help you and your industry colleagues get there. So with that, we're coming to the end of our keynote slot here. I just want to convey my thanks to Nobu for his time at a very late hour in Japan. Are you
still very Friday? 1 minute to go. 1 minute to
So we'll let Nobu get to his Saturday on time. Thank you, Nobu, for your presentation and for your vision. And we do appreciate Astroscale's support of this summit and support of our community overall. So thank you
very much for the great 3 days. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Bye bye.